cause, but all you really need is to just breathe. Third cup of Joe just to get me through the day. Wanna make the most of time, but I feel it slip away. I wonder if there's something more to this crazy life. I'm busy, 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 and it's no surprise to see that I only have time for me, me, me. There's gotta be something more to this crazy life. I'm hanging on tight to another wild day when it starts to fall apart in my heart. I hear you say, just breathe, just breathe, come and rest at my feet. And be, just be, chaos calls, but all you really need is to take it in, fill your lungs, the peace of God that overcomes, just
oh. Welcome you to this in-person service here at Community Church at Murphy's Landing, and welcome all of you who are watching online this morning or later in the week. We are glad that you are worshiping God together, and we're delighted that you're here this morning. We live in days where we need to be reminded that if we have put our faith in Christ, we are His children and we belong to Him. And in the midst of all of the things that are happening, we can be reassured that God loves us, that He's working in our lives, and that we can trust Him. Let's open our hearts to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll lift our voices in praise. Father, we thank You for Your love for us. Your Word tells us how great is the love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. Thank You that through faith in Jesus, we belong to You and to Your family, and that we have confidence that our lives are in Your hands. And so we trust You, and even in these uncertain times where there's much happening that causes many to fear, we realize that You are our rock and our salvation, and we rest in You and we trust You. We pray this morning that as we lift up our voices in praise, as we pray together, as we hear Your Word, we pray that You, Holy Spirit, would move among us and that You would reassure us, reaffirm our standing as Your children, and give us confidence and faith as we face the future ahead of us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen and amen. Thank you, Pastor Paul. Good morning, everybody. Please stand with us. Before we go to worship, we're going to responsively read from God's Word. Today's responsive reading comes from Psalm 106. So I'll start off 1 through 5. Psalm 106. Praise the Lord, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever.
Who can proclaim the mighty acts of the Lord? Or fully declare His praise.
Blessed are those who act justly, who always do what is right.
Remember me, Lord, when You show favor to Your people. Come to my aid when You save them, that I may enjoy the prosperity of Your chosen ones, that I may share in the joy of Your nation and join Your inheritance in giving praise.
Wandering heart to Thee, prone to
God. It's good to worship in person, is it not? It sure is. We raise a hallelujah in this place. We rejoice that we are together under one roof. But this is not God's home, right? It's just a building. You are all individually God's home. We're Christians, and we take that out to the world, and we got to live it, we got to believe it. Amen? Let's raise a hallelujah.
In the middle of the storm,
As we go into our prayer time this morning, I want to give you the opportunity to take a few moments in silent prayer and just lift your request to the Lord. Give him thanks for his blessings, for his protection, and anything that's on your heart. This is your opportunity in these moments of quietness to lift your hearts before the Lord, and then I'll close our prayer time in a few minutes. Father in heaven, we're reminded every day that we live in a fallen and a broken world. We live in a world that has a lot of suffering. We live in a world where people don't know what the future holds. We live in a world where for some people each day is uncertain. Remind us in these times that you call us to turn to you and to put our trust in you and to rest in you. You are our hope. You are our salvation. You are the one who has promised that you never leave us or forsake us. You have given us your Spirit. So give us confidence today to walk each day in your presence, trusting you, knowing that you are at work and that you will accomplish your purposes in our lives. We pray for our nation and for our world that during these days, many people would turn their hearts to you and realize that you are the hope that we have. May they find faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. May they find the peace that comes from your Holy Spirit who dwells within us. And I pray that you will make us, your people, a light to our world, that we might reflect Jesus Christ to the world around us in these times, that we might be those who can point others to the hope that we have. So thank you for hearing our prayers this morning. Thank you for providing for our needs. Thank you for the reassurance that you are here with us. We pray these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to take some time this morning to talk to you about reflecting Christ in these times. And I want to talk about the fact that we were originally created in the image of God. I want to talk to you about the fact that that image was ruined or marred by sin. But I also want to talk to you about the fact that through Jesus Christ, the image of God is renewed in us, and we are to be people who reflect His likeness and His image. I want to start off by saying to you that I believe that all black lives matter to God. I believe that all Hispanic and Latino lives matter to God. I believe that all Asian lives matter to God. I believe that all Indian lives matter to God. I believe that all Caucasian or white lives matter to God. If you look it up, you'll discover that there are more than 5,000 ethnic groups in this world. Now, most of those fall under some broader major categories, but there are more than 5,000 ethnic groups in this world. Before Europeans settled the North American continent, there were dozens of indigenous native groups that had been in America for years and years. They were distinct in their languages, in their cultures, in their beliefs. And if you go down into Mexico and Central America and South America before the Spanish ever settled those regions, there were hundreds of indigenous groups. In fact, there are so many languages spoken in southern Mexico alone that Wycliffe Bible translators have been there for years and years working on translating the Bible into those languages. And all over the world, everywhere you go, you will find different ethnic groups, different languages. Sometimes we refer to them as nationalities if they're associated with their nation. But I believe that we need to hold on to the truth that every black life matters, every Hispanic and Latino life matters, every Asian life matters, every Indian life matters, every Caucasian life, every white life matters to God. So why would we say, living in this country, why would we say that all of these different ethnicities and these nationalities matter? Why do black lives matter? Why do Hispanic lives matter? Why do Indian lives matter? Why do white lives matter? Well, we could go back and we could look at the Declaration of Independence, which tells us that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Our founders determined that these truths were self-evident, that all men are created equal. But there's a higher authority than that. And in fact, that higher authority is what the framers of our Constitution looked to make that declaration. Why all these different nationalities and ethnicities, why do they matter? And I want to suggest to you that it goes back to the very beginning, the story of God and the story of Scripture. It's because we were originally created in the image of God. We were originally created in the image of God. And if you read that passage in Genesis chapter 1, it says, God said, let us make mankind in our image. In other words, we were to reflect God. In our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish in the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock and all wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And then later in Genesis chapter 5, when it begins to list the generations that followed after Adam, it says, this is the book of the generations of Adam. When God created man, he made him in the likeness of God. God made man in his likeness, meaning that we were made to reflect his image, to be like God. And then in the book of Acts, when the Apostle Paul was at Mars Hill in Athens, and when he was making a case for Jesus and for the fact that that he was the one who is God's son, and he was the one true God, in part of that discussion that he has with all of these thinkers and some of them, I suppose, were theologians, philosophers there at Mars Hill in Athens. This is what he said in Acts 17, verses 26. And I think this is a really important verse for the dialogue that's happening right now in our nation and our world. From one man, he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. And I want you to notice the underlined part there. From one man, he made all the nations. So you could say that that original couple that God made, Adam and Eve, they were a mirror image of God. They were given charge over this earth to lovingly rule over it and care for it. They were made in the image of God. Now, an image is a visible representation of something. When we talk about a child and say he's the spitting image of his father, we usually mean he looks a lot like his father, he acts a lot like his father, he behaves a lot like his father. So when we talk about being made in the image of God, that we were created in the image of God, we are a representation of God's nature and his character. An image represents the reality behind it. And Scripture says in the creation story that God breathed his spirit into Adam, and Adam became a living soul. Adam resembled his heavenly father. And human beings were given the capacity to think and to reason, to decide, make decisions, to create, to enjoy beauty, to relate to others, to love, because they were made in the image of God, who from the very beginning of time existed as Father, Son, and Spirit in a unity of relationships, a unity of person. And so humans were given that same capacity. We as human beings, when we were created, were set apart as distinct from all the rest of creation. We were made stewards over the earth to care for the creation in which God had placed us. And the image of God in man forever distinguishes us from the rest of created life. As wonderful and beautiful as the rest of creation is, and the animals and the birds and the fish, I mean, it just blows your mind, the variety and creativity of God. But human beings were set apart as distinct from all the rest of creation, because none of the other parts of creation, it was not said about them, they were created in the image of God. Only human beings, only man and woman were created in the image of God. So, because we are made in God's image, we have unique value and worth as image bearers of God. If we were merely products of chance, like evolution says that we are, then we have no worth. We don't matter. If we just somehow came from nowhere and there is no creator behind it, we ultimately have no value and worth. When you go further in Genesis and you see that the population of the world grew and there was violence that was growing, in Genesis chapter 9, verse 6, there's a prohibition for murder, that you cannot shed the blood of a person without having your own blood shed as a punishment or penalty for that. And there was a reason behind that prohibition of murder, and that's this. God says in Genesis chapter 9, verse 6, he says that you're not to shed the blood of another man because they're made in the image of God. They're made in the image of God. And still today, in part, we bear the image of God, even though it has been distorted by sin. Now, in one of the articles I was reading, they had a really interesting paragraph that I want to share with you. It talks about how we're distorted inside, and that shapes our view of other people. It says, cultural and ethnic differences aside, all human beings are fatally flawed and incapable of knowing the truth about their own origins and spiritual condition without divine intervention. Apart from God's grace, human beings will always fail to see themselves the way they really are. People will artificially raise themselves up by putting others down. They will be intimidated by cultural and ethnic differences without ever realizing their own sinfulness has distorted their perceptions of their fellow human beings. What happened to the human race? We were made in the image of God. We were placed in a beautiful, perfect paradise, a garden as it's described. What happened that we would become people who can't really see our own sinfulness and brokenness and how we project those things onto other people? Well, that brings us to the second point that I want us to understand this morning. We were originally created in the image of God, but the image of God in mankind was marred by sin. So if you look at our fallen human nature, you see it depicted all through Scripture. You see the evil of man. We see it all around us in our world today. It doesn't take much to find an example of the fallenness and the brokenness of human beings. Isaiah 53, verse 6, is a verse that talks about Jesus, the Messiah, who would come and he would give his life as a ransom for people, that he would be the one who would suffer and take our place, and looking ahead to the cross. And Isaiah 53, verse 6, it talks about the fact that we all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each one has turned to his own way, and he has laid the iniquity of us all on him, referring to the Messiah, referring to Jesus. And so in Isaiah 53, we have that statement that all of us have gone astray. All of us have gone our own way. All of us have sinned. In Romans chapter 3, verse 23, it just simply states, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It's a blanket statement. There's not, well, some people have sinned, but these people are pretty good. No, all have sinned and are fallen short of the glory of God. So when Adam and Eve chose to disobey God's command, they were doing so because they wanted to be like God. They wanted to know right from wrong. They wanted to know good from evil. They thought it would make their lives better. But when they disobeyed God and they fell, they lost their moral innocence. When Adam and Eve sinned, the first thing they did was they hid from God. And people have been hiding from God ever since. In the past thousands of years and still today, our natural tendency is to hide from God. Their relationship was affected with God, and their relationship was affected with each other. And they were banned from the Garden of Eden, from the perfect paradise. No longer could they eat of the tree of life through which they would live forever, but they were banned from the presence of God in that garden. And from that day on, the imprint of that rebellion or sin has affected every single person who's been born on this planet. When you get to Genesis chapter 5 and verse 3, it talks about the fact that Seth, Adam and Eve's third son, that Seth was born in the likeness of Adam. So Adam and Eve were created in the image of God or in the likeness of God, but when Seth is born and he begins to describe the whole lineage of Adam following Seth, it says that Seth was born in the image of Adam. In other words, he had Adam's likeness in him. So we know from Scripture and we know from our own experience that we have all gone our own way. We have all strayed from God. We all have a bent towards sin. We have an inward focus, a selfish focus. And the fact of the matter is we want to be in control. We want to be God. And that was the essence. Some people look at the story of Adam and Eve and say, well, what's the big deal? They ate a piece of fruit off of a tree. How it became an apple, I have no idea. But they ate a piece of fruit off of a tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. What's so bad about that? Well, what was wrong with that is, first of all, it was God's command, don't eat it. It was the point of testing of their faith and their trust in him. But also, it was the reason behind their wanting to eat that fruit is because they wanted to know the difference between good and evil. They wanted to be in control of their lives. They wanted to be like God. And we're the same way. If you stop and think about it, the essential problem with us as human beings and our relationships with others is that on our own, apart from God's grace and the work of his Spirit in our lives, we want to have our own way and we want to be in control. And while we might not ever say it, we act as if we want to be God or we are God in our life. And I think we need to be reminded that we are not good, God. We're not good on our own. We're also not God. And if anything, all that's happening with COVID-19, if anything, God is saying to us, I am God and you are not. If there is any message from all this that's happening, it's like God is saying, I'm God and you are not. You need to trust me. And I think that I need to remind myself every day. You need to remind yourself every day. I knew one pastor that put this sign on his office door, and it's simply this: there is a God, and it's not me. There is a God, and it's not me. Because that's the essential problem of human sinfulness, is we put ourselves in the place of God. Now, God's grace has been evident from the very beginning of time, from creation and how he responded to fallen people. I know you can't really shout with a mask on, but try. What did Adam and Eve do after they ate the fruit and knew that they disobeyed God? What did they do? They hid. They hid from God. They hid from God. And here's the beautiful thing about the story. What did God do? He just said, I'm going to start all over again. And he just obliterated the earth. That's not the story. I mean, it's amazing when you read the story of what God did. He went looking for him. He went walking in the cool of the garden in the evening, and most scholars say that probably that was a pattern. God would come down and talk to Adam and Eve. He's walking in the cool of the garden, and he says to them, he calls out to them, Adam, Adam, where are you? And to me, those are some of the most beautiful words in Scripture, because God has been doing that from the very beginning of time right up to today. He's saying to us, Adam, where are you? Jenny, where are you? Ronnie, where are you? I'll pick on people that won't get too mad at me. All was not lost, because God loved and valued those that he had created in his image. And what begins in the very beginning of time, when God takes the skin of an animal and he makes the clothing for them, is he makes provision to cover the sinfulness of fallen humanity. And he loved his people so much that the whole story of Scripture is that he would give his own son. He would give his own son to bring us back to him, to the Father. He loves us. And if you look at human lives down through history, we realize that even though we are fallen and sinful human beings and the image of God has been marred in us, it's not been lost. We have retained the capacity for goodness. We have retained the capacity to reason and make choices. We have intelligence. We have creativity. We have the ability to relate to others and to love. That's all a result of what theologians would call common grace. God gave his grace to mankind that even though we are fallen and we are bent towards sin and we've rebelled against God, there is still in every human person, there are these characteristics or qualities that are a reflection of God. The image has been marred, but it's still there waiting to be renewed. One theologian said, "The gospel is a great unifier. It teaches us that we are all sinners in need of a Savior." Our kids grew up singing a song, "Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white." Now, that's probably not politically correct to use those terminologies today, but the whole point of that song was that the gospel of Jesus Christ, God in his grace, is a great unifier because he loves all people. Scripture teaches us that we are all sinners in need of a Savior. And it tells us that God loves us so much that he sent his only Son. So salvation through Christ is a unifying experience that crosses nationalities and it crosses ethnicities and it crosses socioeconomic statuses and it crosses genders and it crosses everything that divides us. The gospel of Jesus Christ crosses those things. And the salvation brings adoption into God's family through the redemption that was provided in the Messiah, Jesus. And that restores humanity to its proper relationship with Creator, their Creator. That's what God does for us in his grace when he brings us to himself. And when we put our faith in him, it restores our relationship, our proper relationship with our Creator. But it's also intended to restore a right relationship with our fellow man. So if God has restored us to his family through faith, we need to realize that we are being renewed in the image of Christ. Human beings were made and created in the image of God. That image was marred because of sin. But what God does in his grace, when we put our faith in Christ, when we commit our lives to him, is he begins this transformation in our lives where we are being renewed in the image of Christ. And there are several scriptures there. I'm going to look them up and read them. You can jot them down and look them up later, or you can follow with me. The first one is in Romans chapter 8, and it's part of a familiar passage of Scripture. And in that passage, one of the things that the Apostle Paul was talking about was the fact that when we put our faith in Christ, God gives us his Spirit, and through his Spirit, we are adopted into his family, and that we can call God our Father. We can cry, "Abba, Father." And the Spirit itself testifies that we are the children of God and that we are heirs of God. And so there's this wonderful promise in Romans chapter 8 that through Christ, we are brought back into God's family. We are adopted into God's family. And that even through all the suffering that we go through, we can be reassured that God is with us. And his Spirit is with us. And Romans chapter 8 is a great chapter to read. And then we get into the more familiar verse, and we've talked about this at many different times, Romans 8, 28 and 29. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. And now he tells us in verse 29 what that purpose is. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son. So God's purpose for us in adopting us back into his family is to, through his Spirit, it is to conform us or renew us into the likeness of his Son. God's purpose is that we be like Jesus, that we reflect him in our lives. And then there's a couple of passages over in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22 and 24, and then another one in Colossians, where it talks about this change that takes place in us, that we have a new self when we come to Christ, when we're brought into his family. And what Paul is getting at in these passages is that that new self is being renewed in the image of its creator so that we reflect the righteousness and the holiness of God. God's desire for us is to be changed, for his spirit to be changing us so that more and more we are like Jesus and so that our lives reflect him to the world around us. So in Ephesians 4, Paul's talking about how we should live as children of light. He's talking in the latter part about how we should treat each other and the thing, and we looked at one of those verses last week. But in verse 22 and 24 through 24, this is what we read. You were taught with regard to your former way of life. So he's talking about people who have come into God's family, who have put their trust in Jesus, and now Paul is comparing their old life to their new life. He says, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your mind. So there's a transformation, a spiritual transformation that begins to take place in our minds. And then verse 24 says, and put on the new self created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. So the work of God through what Jesus did for us and through the Holy Spirit is to transform and to change us so that we are being recreated or renewed to be like God so that we reflect him. And then it gets even more specific over just a few pages in Colossians chapter 3, verses 9 and 10. And Paul's likewise talking about how we're to live our lives as followers of Jesus. And he says in verse 9, do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self. There's this spiritual transformation. There's this decision that we make to put off the old self with its practices. And you have put on the new self, and listen to this, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. So this is the full circle picture of the gospel. The image of God, we were created in the image of God to be like him and to be in perfect fellowship with him. We lost that when man sinned and rebelled against God, and that image of God has been marred or ruined in our life. God's purpose through Christ and through the Spirit is that that image of Christ, that image of God, would be renewed in our lives. And that new self that is created within us is in the image of our Creator. And it's to reflect the righteousness and the holiness of God. And then one more verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 17 and 18. And I think this is beautiful to me because it shows that we should be increasingly reflecting the likeness of Christ, or we should be increasingly reflecting the image of Christ. We should be increasingly becoming more and more like Jesus. And so in 2 Corinthians 3, verses 17 and 18, this is what we read. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we who with unveiled faces all reflect the Lord's glory are being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. Now, when Paul writes and says that, when he talks about we with unveiled faces, it's a reference back to when Moses would be in God's presence. And if he took a veil or took a covering off of his face, the glory of God, you know, shone so much that the people were terrified. And so Moses would often have to cover his face because the glory of God was so evident in his life. And here it's talking about the fact that we, as God's people, we should have unveiled faces. That means that there is nothing hidden, there's nothing put back, there's nothing held back. We with unveiled faces reflect the Lord's glory. And then I love this. We are being transformed into his likeness. I mean, that's an amazing thing. God's not content to just say, all right, well, I've forgiven him and he's going to heaven. No, God's purpose is to transform us and to change us so that more and more we reflect Jesus, and that's his purpose in our life. We are being transformed into his likeness with ever-increasing glory. In other words, more and more and more and more in our lives, we should reflect Christ to our world. It's not like, okay, I've come to faith in Jesus and that's all that matters and now I can do my own thing. No, it's more and more and more in our lives with ever-increasing glory. We should be reflecting Jesus in our world. And as people who reflect Christ to our world, the world we live in today, we should focus on what Paul says, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable. That's in Philippians 4, verse 8. Paul goes on to say, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. If we are going to reflect Christ to our world, we need to focus on what is true and noble and right and pure and lovely and admirable and excellent and praiseworthy. What if we put that test or standard to the media today? We wouldn't have anything to watch. Most likely, we wouldn't have anything to watch. But if we are God's people who are being changed into the likeness of Christ, those need to be the things that we focus on. And we should be characterized by the fruit of the Spirit that Paul describes in Galatians chapter 5. And the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. So as we come to a close this morning, I want to ask you this question. If we are created in the image of God, and he is renewing his image and his likeness in us, and if we are supposed to reflect Christ to the world around us, how does that impact our response to what is happening right now in our nation and in our world? How does that impact our response during these challenging times? Or you could put it another way. How should we treat other people in these days of hostility, anger, disagreement, conflict, and violence? And I want to suggest to you these things that tie in with what we've been talking about. First of all, we need to remember that every person, no matter how violent, hateful, and sinful, is a person whom God loves and desires to save and restore to his family. Every person is a person who Christ died for. Secondly, we need to recognize that the evil things people do and say come from their fallen, sinful nature. And in that sense, we can't just blame society, even though there may be a lot of fault there, but the evil things that people say and do come from their fallen, sinful nature. We need to refuse to despise and hate any person. If everyone is created in the image of God, if everyone is created in the image of God, we cannot despise and hate any person. We need to ask God to renew our inner self so that we reflect the character of Christ. And our desire should be that we reflect that image of Christ more and more and more. And we should seek to bring reconciliation wherever there is separation from God or wherever there is conflict between people. Remember, everyone is loved by God. Recognize that evil things that people do come from a fallen, sinful nature. Refuse to despise anyone. Ask God to renew your inner self so you reflect Jesus, and then seek to bring reconciliation wherever you can. I want to close in a different way this morning. I'm going to ask you to stand. I know it's a challenge to read something with a mask, and I'm really glad I get to stand up here and don't have to wear one. So bless your hearts for wearing them and considering other people. But I want to close this prayer in unison and read it together. O God, you have made of one blood all the peoples of the earth, and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near. Grant that people everywhere may seek after you and find you. Bring the nations into your fold. Pour out your Spirit upon all flesh, and hasten the coming of your kingdom through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. God bless you all. Go in the grace and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ.